And we say that every person has been given a talent. And when God gives a talent to you, He expects you to multiply that talent and bring profit. Our God, if I would put it in simple terms, is like a business person. He never invests and does not expect a return. That is why when He invested Jesus and allowed Him to die on the cross, He was expecting, and He still continues to expect, that He will get many sons and daughters to His kingdom. So our God is an investor. And that is why the Bible says in the book of Ephesians that there is an inheritance in you. In fact, I want us to open that scripture because Ephesians chapter 1, there is a powerful statement concerning an inheritance. Verse 17, or from verse 16, the Bible says, I cease not to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, verse 17, the Father of glory, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of His calling. You know, God called you. Many of us do not know what is in the calling. You do not know the hope of the calling. And that's why God says, Paul was saying, that he prays that God may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation, that you may know the hope that is in the calling. Amen. Some of you still complain, why did God save me? Amen. But your eyes have not been opened. That's why it is so important to ask God to enlighten your eyes. And the Bible says, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of His calling, and what the riches of the glory of His inheritance in the saints. His inheritance in the saints. His inheritance in the saints. There is an inheritance that belongs to God that is in you. Say, how are they? God, say, God has an inheritance. Say, God has an inheritance. So don't deny God's inheritance, because there is you are not apart from you physically. There is something that God has put in you that belongs to Him. It is His inheritance. It belongs to Him. And so my prayer is that your eyes may be open to understand what is the inheritance that belongs to God, that is locked up in you. And when He comes back, He expects that you traded with that inheritance. That you did something concerning that inheritance. Some of you, it is a gift for business, for trading. That you may trade and impact many people.
Amen.
That you may employ many people. One as a spirit. Some of you, there are songs that God has put in you that you may be able to sing. And when you sing, people get healed. People get delivered. People get changed. Some of you, it is a gift of being a doctor, being a lawyer, that you can defend people who are in prison. One as a spirit. There are so many people who are in prison who never did anything wrong. God put in you an inheritance for you to become a lawyer so that you can defend people, not just not to make money, but out of the process, you make your money. But at the end of the day, when God comes back, He wants a report.
Amen.
Now, it is not God's responsibility to give you an enlightenment of your eyes to know what is deposited in you. Paul said, I pray for you. I make mention of you in my prayers that God may open your eyes, that you may know the glory of the riches. There is so much glory of the riches that are locked in that inheritance.
Amen.
So much glory. You don't know who you are. It's only that many of us do not spend time to ask God, what have you deposited in me? What have you deposited in me? I did not go to Boston or to the Brazil or even preach here. I did not go there because I was Julius. I went there because there was an inheritance, which is the preaching of the Word of God. When I discovered, it begins to open doors.
Amen.
There is an inheritance in you. And you must take time to seek God until you find it. One has a few.
Amen.
You must pray until you find it. If you have children, you must pray for your children until they find their inheritance. Because we have been programmed by the systems of the world that there are things we must do. From class 1, you do probably 7 subjects or 8 subjects. And you're not even allowed to go beyond the 8 subjects. Because if you try something outside door, you're being told you're learning too much. So you're put in a system. You're conformed to the standards of the world. Then you join high school. And suddenly you have all of you have to do chemistry. Even if you don't understand it. Now I try to get a point of maybe, you know, for me, for example, I hated physics and history. Those were my some of the subjects that I didn't like. Now can you imagine you're put in a system, I will never become a physicist, but I'm forced to follow a system. I'm not saying that you don't go to school. You must because it's a system. But I want you as a Christian to open your mind beyond the education. Because there's something, and the government, after many years, not even the government, scholars are beginning to see that there's something beyond the normal education. That's why they're introducing different kinds of education. They're saying, let us begin to discover talents, because they're discovering that only the talents that are locked up in men can be able to change the nation. Because where do you take millions and millions of accountants that are being released every single year? Where do you take them? You don't even have jobs enough for them. But there are people who have got different abilities who can be able to do different things, not necessarily through the education system, but through the discovery of the inheritance of God in them. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So God has locked up something in you. And we say to you, you also need to understand that nothing belongs to you, including you don't belong to you. You belong to God. And therefore God, you should be ready to be used by God in any way. Until you release yourself, until you release your children to discover who they are and to begin to follow God's path, then there is a challenge. Until you accept that you don't belong to you and God can give you an assignment anywhere in this world and to do anything according to what is inside you, then that is the time you begin to enjoy your freedom. The time with Pastor James, we said, okay, God, if you have called us to be pastors, we agree. Then everything else, the heavens was unlocked. The heavens were unlocked. The heavens were unlocked.
Amen.
Money you could not get when you were doing other things, other businesses. When you tried other businesses, when you had refused to become pastors, money would get lost. But from the day God, we accepted that God, we belong to you, use us the way you want to use us, then maybe things began to unlock. What are you doing?
Amen.
And things will begin to unlock the day you accept and tell God, Lord, I release myself to you. I agree to be used by you, and I agree that you show me what you created me for. And that is one question most people don't want to ask God, because you are too scared. He might tell you that you're not supposed to be doing the business you're doing. Many of us are too scared to ask God, what did you create me for? Because if God tells you that he created you to become an accountant, and you're a driver now, and you've been comfortable as a driver, you may wonder, what do I do? What do I do? So it's a high time you realize that you don't belong to you. And when you agree to that, then God, and let me tell you something, God is not a waster of resources. He's not a waster. He still uses the knowledge of accounting that I used in school. He still uses the English, my wife, but you always see her correcting me here. God still uses, he doesn't take you to school. He's a God who says, all things work together for good, to those who are called and those who love God. So when you love God, even that degree, that diploma, that certificate, God will still use it in one way or another. One
amen.
Is he a good amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
He's a wonderful God. So you have to use the talent, and God will never begin from the top. You will never sing the first song and it become a hit. You will never draw the first drawing and it becomes the best. You will never do somebody's hair and somebody tells you you're the best hair maker. It is a process of polishing that gift little by little until it becomes a best, the best gift that God has given. God has given. Because the reason why the church is not as efficient and powerful as it should be is because we pray too much, and which is okay, but we do not do what we are supposed to do. Prayer is important because the Bible says pray without ceasing. But as I said last week, God is looking for people who will manage the resources that are here on earth. And we saw it in Genesis chapter 2, I think verse 15, that God said he could not send rain, nor could he allow plants to grow, because there was no man to manage. No man to manage. So God is looking for resource managers. He's looking for people who will manage what has been given to them. How are you managing your life? Because if you cannot be able to manage your own life, how can you manage anybody else's life? That is why the Bible says there are so many people who are called to be pastors. But the Bible says a man or a woman who cannot be able to take care of his own family, how can you even be entrusted with the other people's families? That is why there are so many people who are called to preach the word of God. But when God looks at you as a man or as a woman, you are not responsible. You cannot even take care of one husband. One husband is giving you a headache. One. What if God gives you 10 husbands in a church and they have trouble? How will you handle? What will you tell them? If one wife is giving you sleepless weeks, what if the women in church begin to tell you their issues? So if God is looking for management of resources, if you cannot manage your own life, then he cannot take you to the next level. So we have to accept responsibility, and we have to accept capacity. And I said this last week, that God will not answer your prayer for anything extra according to that prayer. He will answer you according to your ability to manage anything that he gives you. That is why some of you are in the level of just enough. Because if he gives you more than enough, you cannot manage it. You move away from church. If he gives you more than what you're adding now, 10,000 is your level. If God adds you 15,000, you bring trouble. You bring trouble to everybody. In fact, you begin to ask, why is my seat not so? Why is it dusty? Because you're wondering, at my caliber, I earn 15,000. How can they allow me to sit on a seat like this one? In fact, we need to have cushions. 15,000, bringing trouble to people. Because God will only release to you according to your ability. One as if you will. According to your ability. Amen. Amen. And today I'm looking at the second level. We said the first level is the talent God has put in you. The second level, it is the level of the word of God. The Bible talks about the kingdom of heaven many times. Look at Matthew chapter 13. The Bible talks about the kingdom of heaven many times. And God speaks about the kingdom of heaven being like a seed. Now think about the kingdom. If I say Kenya is like a seed, you'll be like, how? Because Kenya is a big nation. But a seed is a small thing. But God keeps on talking every time when he's comparing the kingdom of heaven, many times, comparing the kingdom of heaven to small things. Very small things. Now some people are stranded because the World Bible is not coming up. That is why today I'm preaching also. Because many people have not taken responsibility of knowing of how to handle the word of God. We are still too casual with the way we handle God. And if you cannot be able to handle the seed of the word of God, then how can you be entrusted with more? Matthew chapter 13.
You're there.
Matthew chapter 13. You're there?
Yes.
If you're there with your Bible, that is good. Today we'll have a quick wrap-up for some Bibles, because there are some nice Bibles. Some people are pursuing and looking for extra ones. Hallelujah. Now the Bible says in verse 31, another parable put forth unto them, saying, verse 31, the kingdom of God is like to a grain of mustard seed, which a man took and sowed in his field, which indeed is the least of all seeds, least of all seeds. But when it is grown, it is the greatest among herbs, and it becometh a tree, so that the birds of the air come and lodge in the branches thereof. The kingdom of God is like a grain of a mustard seed. The kingdom of God. Many of us are waiting for things, big things that God is going to do. And it is okay, because he says he will do exceeding abundantly above what you ask or think. But he says, for you to receive the big, you must, number one, receive the kingdom of God like a mustard seed. Right now, the kingdom of God is being released to you through the word of God. It is being released, but many of you are missing the kingdom of God because you think the kingdom of God is in cars. God will plant a seed in you that when you take care of it, it will give you anything that you want.
Amen.
The Bible says the kingdom of God is like a mustard seed. Mustard seed. If you have ever seen a mustard seed, one day will my wife, I think she does those herbal things. So she showed me a mustard seed. It is something that you cannot even be able to hold properly. And so we are missing out on the blessedness of the kingdom of God because we are looking for big things and God has said, my kingdom is hidden in small.
Amen.
My kingdom is hidden in little. If you can be able to take that little seed that the kingdom of God is and take care of that seed in the right way, it will give you results that you cannot be able to imagine. It will give you results that you can be able to imagine. But what happens? We ignore the moment when the seed of the kingdom of God is being released to us. Why is it that the church, we don't even write notes? Because we think we will remember. And I will show you from the scripture how we miss out the kingdom of God. If I was to ask you, what were the last week's sermon? What were the scriptures? What were the scriptures? Many of you would not remember. Many of you will be saying it was a great sermon, but many of you cannot be able to remember what was spoken. But you can be able to remember the whole of this week, a program that has come on TV concerning some Sijui Mapenzi love, I don't know, and not evil, from a South American opera. You can be able to remember from Monday to Friday what was happening to that person, word verbatim. But when it comes to the last week's sermon, many of you cannot even remember the scripture.
I will do an example. You go to church last week.
Are you in church last week? I'm just trying to show you what was happening in church. Many people are in church, but many people are not. They are losing the kingdom of God. They are losing their blessing because they cannot remember. In fact, people will say, I said my Galatians chapter 4:1. And do you remember what it says? She knows it, but she does not remember what it says. And I'm not trying to show you that you are a mess, but I'm just trying to show you a small sample. Now, I know you're scared that I'm coming your way. You're so scared because that is what is happening in the kingdom of God. People are expecting miracles, but you are seeing the seed that was spoken last week, you didn't take care of it. You could not manage the little thing that God gave you last week. He gave you mustard seeds. Because it was not one scripture. We are talking about more than four or five or six scriptures that were quoted. But because the pastor did not put them up there, they were not the relevant scripture. Because even when I'm speaking, there are scriptures that God will put in me. But because they are not in the sermon, you miss out. You don't write them down. And so you're waiting for miracles that will never come. And I will show you from the word. Because God changes life through planting of seeds. And so many of you are expecting miracles, but they will never come. I'm giving you a truth. Miracles that will never, ever come. Because you never took care of the seed that was planted by God. It was stolen. It was so small, you never realized that you had a seed. If I give you a maize seed today, most likely, if I don't tell you to take care of it, most likely if I ask you for the same seed on Sunday, one seed, you'll not have it. Because it is too small to see, it is too small to be taken care of, you don't even know where probably you place it. And that's what is happening. In the kingdom of God, many people are missing out on the miracles because when they were given a packet of seeds, they looked at the seed and they said, this is too small. Pastor will come again on Sunday and will declare, no evil shall come near you. So I don't have to take care of this seed this week. Because next week there will be more seed. And so if you cannot take care of the seed that you are given today by God, then next week, He will not give you anything. Many sermons have been said, if only people could take one sermon and hold on to it so strongly, they will get miracles. waiting for miracles, and miracles disappeared a long time ago. If you look at anybody who has received anything, the Bible says, what is not of faith, it is sin. Anybody in God who has received a miracle, this is why God says, the husband said, God will take care. She took hold of a seed that was planted in her. She didn't take a lawyer with her to the police station. The father was not there. But there was a seed that was planted in her by the husband who spoke, and that seed worked for her. She took care of it. Many of us do not even know a scripture they can stand on if your husband is taken by another woman. Many of you do not even have a scripture that you can stand on if you are sick. Many of you do not have a scripture. You are believing God for cars, but you don't even have a scripture that you are holding on to get a car one day. Many of you want multiplication, but many of us do not have even the scriptures for multiplication. You only wait when you'll be given a scripture from the pulpit. Let us pray this scripture. So you pray for that moment, but the moment it is taken away, you can't remember it. And that is the mistake that we're making. That is the mistake. That is why we don't have notebooks. Our God had to use men to sit down years and years to subscribe and write what he was speaking. He put in record so nobody can be able to say, God, I misquoted you. Nobody can be able to misquote God. But us, with our little minds that has been given by God, we are too, let me put it the right way, we are too proud to carry a notebook because we think we can remember. If God himself had to make sure the word of God is written and it is every year being translated into new versions of Bibles, and he keeps on writing, and yet we think we can remember. How are some of these children going to come with notebooks to church if the parents cannot be writing anything? How? How can we? I have notebooks from Winners Chapel. I have notebooks from JCC. They have been written. All the notes that I have written, I have them. My wife, I saw a book. My wife was writing notes when she was in primary. Prayer points she was making. Some of you do not even know if God answered your prayer because you don't even keep a record of prayers that you have made. The reason why David has got prayers in the Psalms is because he was keeping a record. How could they have been written? Because somebody was writing what they were praying. And when God answers their prayers, they are able to look back and say, Father, I thank you because you answered prayers. Some of you have spent money to have bought a Bible this week. I wish the men's conference that people are running to were sending that money to buy Bible for their wives. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Because things are not going to change for. You know, we're getting miracles, but they're coming in, you know, little miracles. Why? Because you lay hold of that seed, and that seed, somehow, you let it go. Now the Bible says in Matthew chapter 13, verse 4. Verse 3, and he spoke many things unto them in parables, saying, behold, the sower went forth to sow. And when he sowed, some seeds fell by the wayside, and fowls came and devoured them up. Some fell upon stony places, where there not much earth. And forthwith they sprang up, and because they had no deepness of the earth, the sun was up, and they were scorched. And because they had no root, they withered away. Some fell among thorns, and the thorns sprang up and choked them. Others fell into good ground and brought forth fruit, 100-fold, some 60-fold, some 30-fold. Who has ears to hear, let him hear. And the disciples came and said unto him, why do you speak unto them in parables? He answered unto them, because it is given unto you, to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, but to them it is not given. God has chosen you to understand the parables, but them outside cannot understand parables. And the reason why he wants you to understand parables is so that you can begin to apply what God has spoken. Verse 16 says, but blessed are your eyes, for they see. Verse 16, blessed are your eyes, for they see, and your ears, because they hear. You have blessed ears, you have blessed eyes. Say amen.
Amen.
You have blessed eyes, you have blessed ears, but you are not looking in the right direction. You are not listening to the right things. If you are to spend time the way you spend time on WhatsApp and on television, seeing the word of God, your life would have been changed a long time ago. Your miracle would have come a long time ago.
Amen.
The kingdom of God is hidden in living. For the Bible says, the sower, who is God, sows the seeds of the word. Your miracle is in the seed of the word. Your miracle is in the seed of the word. Because God will never come and give you a harvest. God does not come through harvest. He comes through a seed. The sower sowed a seed. He sowed a seed. So God is planting seeds now. God is planting seeds now. And the Bible says, there are believers who, when they heard the word of God, it fell on the wayside. It fell on the wayside. Today I want to concentrate on that. It fell on the wayside. And the fowls of the air came and took the seed and ate the seed. If you cannot take care of a seed that you have been given, you will never receive a harvest. If you cannot take care of the seed that you have been given, because it is already planted, there are so many seeds that have been planted in you. If you cannot be able to take care of that seed that has been planted, be sure that you miss out a miracle. Assuming this place is a farm, and I'm given seeds enough to plant in this farm, I can take care of the seed that I'm holding, but if I do not plant that seed and take care of it, I will never receive a harvest. Your harvest is locked up in a sown seed. Your harvest. The husband you're looking for is in the seed of the word of God that has come your way before, but you have ignored it. Your car, your house, your money, your wisdom, your understanding, anything that you need is locked up in the seed of the word of God, and not necessarily from a preacher, even by reading the word of God yourself. When I saw the scripture that was written, it's an evil thing for the children of God to walk on feet. Evil. Children of God to walk on feet. It changed my mind. I shared with my wife. It changed our minds. And I began to look at it as evil. This is an evil to walk on feet when it is okay to walk on feet. But the Bible says it is an evil. I have seen an evil under the sun. Look at it in Ecclesiastes. Because you have quoted it here before, but you can look for it in Ecclesiastes. Then discover it yourself. If you want a car. Now the Bible says, I have seen an evil under the sun. Princes are walking on feet. And servants are riding horses. Now that is what happens. You sit on Thika Road, you sit on Mombasa Road, servants are riding horses. And the children of the mighty God, kings, are stopping. Inaenda kusimama hapo na kibia hapo, apake meja, narudi stage. Na zingine unaifukuza, unafukuza uriya zako, mtu aliona gari, akaona hiyo inaenda Kenyatta. Hakuna namba vizuri, akaifukuza. Akafika Kenyatta, akaangalia hapo mbele kona A. Ilikuwa inaenda, akafika town, akafika Kenyatta, akaangalia hapo mbele kona A. Inaandikwa kwa Wagwale. Akarudi mpaka ile stage alikuwa ametoka, kwa Kenyatta. Now the thing is, princes are walking. Princes are walking. Servants are riding horses. When I saw that word, something changed. I was like, no, I refuse this evil. Because the Bible says, no evil shall come near me. So I began to make a confession. I refuse the evil of walking while servant. If all of us are walking, it is okay. But as long as I can see a servant riding on a horse, and I do not have a horse, and today's horse is a car, is a motorcycle, is a bicycle, something has to change. And we stood on that scripture, and cars began to flow. Cars began to come.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
The sower sows the word. If you cannot take care of a seed, you will never get a harvest. The devil is interested in the seed. He is not interested in your harvest, because some people are calling for your harvest and you don't have any. How now? I claim my harvest. You don't have any. Because you never planted. The first thing, the word never settled in your heart. The reason why many of us are not receiving the blessedness of tithing is because you tithe, but the word is not in your heart. You keep on tithing, but you do not believe what the Bible says. When the Bible says that I will open the windows of heaven, you have never believed that part. You have never meditated, and that one has never settled in your heart. That is why you give tithe grudgingly. Because you have never seen the miracle of the seed of that one. Because God will tell you to do things physically, but if you do not understand them spiritually, they will never. The devil is interested. If he can be able to steal the seed that God has given him, he knows you will wait until cows come back home without a harvest. You will keep on waiting. Now listen to this. I was looking at one seed. I was doing the mathematics. I did the research. One maize seed. If you plant one maize seed in good soil, take care of it so seriously, by the end of 4 months, you receive a harvest of at least 800 seeds. 800. If you just take care of one plant, kabahi, it grows, it grows, it grows. You take care of it seriously. Every day watching over it that it is not eaten by goats, that you water it. Eventually, after 4 months, you will receive a maize crop, and I'm putting as the minimum. You receive 1 ton of maize, and sometimes they produce 2, and sometimes 3. But the minimum you can get is 1 maize crop, and if you hesap carefully those crops, because many of you have never even done the mathematics of God to see how many seeds are in 1 crop. I know you have never. I know you have never. Because one day we are reading the scripture that is in Deuteronomy 18, chapter 1, verse 11, that the Bible says, may God multiply you 1,000 times. You are like 1,000 times? You mean God, you are able to multiply that? Then he said, check on the maize. So you take one maize crop. God is able to multiply maize that is not human. You are a human being. He cares about you more than maize. But maize goes to the ground, and when it gives a harvest, 800 seeds.
Amen.
So your seeding, if it is invested with the right mentality in the kingdom of God and in the right way, you water it, one day it can multiply and become 1,000.
Amen.
What else if you will? So you take care of this maize until 4 months are over, 800 seeds. Now, if you plant 800 seeds, now maybe Patrick can help with this, eh? You require 38 feet by 22 feet piece of land to plant that one maize crop that has given you 800 seeds. So if you plant one, you will need maybe 40 feet by 30 feet. When you come up, you can go up a dome. This was a piece of plot that was 40 by 30. You come up here. You can go and measure. What has you feel? Can you imagine in a place like this one, you plant 800 seeds. Now, do you know what those 800 seeds will give you? How many seeds they'll give you? They will give you, when you harvest, every harvest from that those 800, you will get 640,000 seeds. 640,000 seeds out of one seed that was planted the second time. Now, when 640,000 seeds, do you know how many seeds need to be planted in 1 acre? 34,000. 1 acre requires 34,000 seeds. 34,000. So, by the time you are harvesting the second harvest, you have seeds enough to plant 18 acres. 18 acres. Now, continue doing the math, multiply by 800, you'll go mad. Because you'll start wondering, maybe they can become. Because some of you have got land. 1 acre in a country, but you are ignoring that 1 acre. You keep on ignoring that 1 acre because you are saying it is too small. What can come out of this? And God gave you a miracle in that 1 acre.
Amen.
He gave you a miracle. Some of you are, nakamu na uzanjuku barabarani, umekaa hivi na uzanjuku, utatengo. By the end of the evening, you have only 200. I wish you went back to your country and planted jute when you continue selling on the roadside, but plant your own field.
Amen.
Because you have a shepherd. Somebody wants to leave Nairobi and go sell the shepherd country. Because it's bringing nothing. And your miracle is there. Your miracle is seated right there. How many of you eat mangoes here? This mango season. How many of you come from a place where mangoes grow? You know what you call what I eat? I know Kenya almost everywhere mangoes grow. So if you're not lifting up your hand, you don't know what you do. So what am I trying to say? One seed taken care of gives 800. When the 800 are taken care of, gives 640,000, 18 acres. Now, if you are graceful enough to sell that maize to Kenya Cereals Board, if there is no corruption, for 3,000 a bag, with from one seed, and you don't touch that seed and you keep on taking care of it, if each bag was sold for 3,000, 1 acre is able to give about 60 bags. Now, if you do the math, by the end of the third harvest, you can have gotten 2.1 million in your pocket. 2.1. Now, that is natural physical seed. Natural physical seed. Now, God has got seeds he keeps on giving you that are so precious. But we trample down the seeds that we receive from God because they do not mean anything. And God is not looking for a physical space to plant the seeds. He's not looking. God is not looking for an acre to plant the seeds. You are the ground. The Bible says your heart is the ground. Your heart is the ground. So, some of you are 1 acre, some of you are 100 acres, some of you are 1,000 hectares, some of you are 10,000 acres because your capacity is bigger. And God is only looking for somebody who is ready with his heart to receive a seed. This is what the Bible is saying. Verse 19. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom, when anyone, including you children, anyone, when anyone hears the word, not even the words, the word of the kingdom, this word is loaded, the word of the kingdom, and does not understand it, does not understand it. This is the danger. When the word, anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it. That is what we are praying for, understanding. And does not understand it, because this is the key. This is the secret of harvest. The moment you fail to understand the word of God and you are chewing log in church, you are wondering what is the pastor saying, you need to lay hands on your head and say, Father, give me understanding, because I'm missing out. Because the planting is going on, but somebody is not understanding. So what is happening? The Bible says, then cometh the wicked one. Then comes the wicked one. And catches away which was sown in his heart. Then comes the wicked one. Right now, there are people who are waiting for harvest. But the wicked one was waiting. Right now, let me tell you something. Keep on binding the devil in church. He is not in the atmosphere. But to some of you, the devil is personal. He's so personal, he pursues you because he's looking. The devil is looking. He knows those people who understand. He knows. He knows those who are understanding right now. He knows. So if you're thinking about your iron box at home, you're thinking about how you will date your wife, or you will meet that girlfriend. He knows. Because he's the one who is putting that idea. It is not God. Do you know when you're seated and you're worried, what will I eat for lunch? The devil knows, because the body was put by him. So he's saying, all I'm trying to get. The devil is not interested in anything. He is interested in your understanding. The Bible says, when you do not understand, God has got no ability. Listen to me. God has got no ability to stop the wicked one. In fact, he's the one who is saying, the wicked one comes and catches away that which was sown in his heart. This is which received seed by the wayside. How many seeds have you received by the wayside? How many? So many of us have received seeds.
Yes.
You received seed on the wayside, but you did not understand it. You took it casually. You took it casually. You went back home and you say, next Sunday is when I think I'll understand that one. So I will not even meditate on it. I will not meditate on it. I tell you, in fact, if you notice today, and I'm that you study, do you know, I slept at 5. I woke up at 11 and began reading this scripture. And I was like, looking at it, I was like, oh my God. You mean every moment I refuse to understand the word of God, the wicked one will take away the seed. And I'm here confessing that I'm waiting for my harvest. And I'm waiting for nothing because it was stolen away a long time ago. And I kept on praying, I kept on praying, I kept telling, Father, give us understanding. My spirit man was too awake. I could not sleep. In fact, I went to bed and I tried to sleep, I couldn't sleep. So I think 6 o'clock came and sleep came. Then I think they came and I woke up. I'm telling you the truth, I woke up like this today at 10:15. I know some of you will not want to tell. I was telling my wife, dude, I'm woken up at 10:15. I got shocked. But I was meditating on this one because I was like, Father, I do not want ever to miss out on a word that is being sold. But you would rather stay away from church. Stay away from church and come to church and sleep. You would rather stay away from church and come, instead of coming to think and people thinking of the way I'm dressed. You would rather stay away from church, instead of just coming to church to look at your neighbors. You would rather stay away. Because that is number one, a mockery to the one who is carrying a bag of seeds. God is a farmer. He is a farmer. Right now, he's planting seeds into everyone, including those children that are sitting there.
Oh, yes.
Including them that are sitting there. Our water king, Musaid, Yukokasini, he's not looking at age. He's planting. Mazmundo says, God called him at the age of 14. By the time he was 16, he was talking on national television and everybody was listening to him by the time he was 16. So don't tell me that if you are a 14-year-old boy, 15-year-old girl, that you have no time for God. You can receive a seed. He said he read the Bible from the beginning to the end when he was about 15 years old. His mind changed. 15 years old, he read the Bible from the beginning to the end. Today, everybody speaks of Miles Monroe. Because of one encounter with the Bible, he said every day would wake up. And God never told you to cram. He told you to meditate and read. Then the Holy Spirit came in the New Testament and he said, I will remind you of the things that you read.
Yeah.
I will remind you. So you keep on reading. But the seed that was sown in him, he was saying one meeting. They call him for a meeting. Organizations, not only churches, organizations call for a meeting. The minimum he's paying is $50,000 to speak for 1 hour. $50,000. Why? Because the seed is in him and he has a mighty harvest. Mighty harvest. You cannot afford to take God's word lightly. You can't afford. I'm telling you, kama utakuja kanisa ukatae kusikia neno la Mungu, ukatae kuliandika chini uende nyumbani ukameditate, then you can be able to quote it next Sunday. Then you would rather stay at home instead of being mocked or mocking God. Because many Christians are mocking God. Don't open up that television to say that I'm listening to Benny Hinn and then you're cooking and you know you're not paying attention. Because that is mockery. If you want to listen to the word of God, sit down and listen to that word of God seriously. Listen to it. Listen to it. What has the feeling?
Amen.
The only ingredient God is looking for to make you successful are three things. Number one, he already has his word. That is the seed. And when you don't understand it, the devil takes it away. The seed. Number one, the seed. Number two, the Bible says, your heart. How many of you have heart? Remember, Kona, how many of you have no heart? Because your heart is your land. Say, my land. So your wealth is with you. Because many of you are thinking your business is failing is because there is a recession. I told you last week, go to Thika Road, go to Westlands, go to Mombasa Road, sit down, you will see the cars people are driving. When you're saying there is no money, somebody is saying, there is too much money. Can't handle it.
Amen.
Too much. So your acres, or your hectares, because some of you are hectares, you have capacity. Hectares, that's all you need. If you have a heart, you qualify for God's seed. And the Bible says, that's what the Bible says, guard your heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. Guard it. Because when God plants a seed, and then you sit down before television and you're watching pornography, that is not guarding your heart, because that is poison to your seed. When you sit and keep on watching movies where people are divorcing and divorcing and divorcing and marrying and marrying and marrying 10 times and you're smiling when... Now, if I remember the way some of us watch movies, you know, it is only in the movies where Christians support thieves. Especially when I got a movie with a bad credit. How could I see a poor bear? God, as if you were escaped. Okay, the police are talking up on a gun. You start getting angry. Can you imagine what the devil has done to our minds? He just changes you. Suddenly, when it is a movie, you love thieves. In fact, you are happy when... How many of you have ever watched the movie Takers? Yeah, I know you have watched it. You know, you're happy when those guys have stolen money from the bank and they are not caught. And you're like, you're moving for poor, sir. So Hollywood, I'm telling you, Hollywood is amazing. It can tell people. That is the only place where men are cheating on their wives and you can see it's going to like a concubine. I mean, an unlucky. You almost pray for the man to succeed. Now what is happening? Something is changing in you slowly. It is changing in you. That is why the devil is after these young people, because they are watching cartoons. And the cats are kissing. When you're watching a grown-up movie and you see a man and a woman, they're kissing, you're watching from here. But when a cat and another cat they're doing, you're like, you're cartoon funny. Because you don't know what the devil is doing, he's planting something. My first Sunday school was with Esther. I almost took a child to heaven. I'm just joking. But I'm teaching them a song. And there is this boy who is looking at somebody's daughter, a small girl. So I'm looking at that boy and I'm singing in the middle so I have to finish the song. But I'm looking at the boy, I'm like, hey boy, stop doing that or I come at you. So we continue to sing. Eventually, the young girl, I can't say the girl because the father or the mother are here. The young girl innocently happened to look at the boy, and the boy was, and the woman type, can you help me? And the girl was so shocked. And I looked at the boy, where did he land up from? My grace disappeared, lifted. You know, touch ended for Sunday. Can I help you? I'll do something to you. My grace disappeared. I forgot the song I was teaching. It was man-made. I had composed it there. Don't think about that. And you don't know what. Let me tell you, when you were growing up, as Mobaga and Alisa, I would watch cartoons with them. Because I'm not watching because I like cartoons, but I'm like, I want to make sure what they are watching, I'm being careful. And they reach a time when they would see advertisement for alcohol, they would switch it off. Because I knew what alcohol, those advertisements were doing. You are creating pictures in the minds. Because some of you, you know, I remember the first time I smoked a cigarette was not because I wanted to smoke, but because every time I would go to Kenya Cinema or Cameo Cinema, and you're watching before, you know, the fun part was advertisements. They come, and you see Pal and Dean. Come on, Adjuaga, Pal and Dean, when you say, Pal and Dean, start looking for your pension. That was the advertising company for the movie theaters. And suddenly they bring the advertisement for cigarettes. And there is this lady riding in the wind with a man. And I'm looking at it, and eventually they end up in a place where there's a restaurant. And they are served food. Then the man removes a cigarette. Then they put the lamp there. And I'm like, when I grow up, I want to take this thing. Because you can make somebody drive in a convertible all the way to that stretch of land and sit in a place and you're offered a drink and there is no care. Because that's what's happening. Every day you're sitting down there thinking that condom advertisement is not affecting the kids. It is doing something. They would not have put it there if they were not interested. If you think that alcohol advertisement is not changing them, something is changing them. If you think when they're watching those cartoons nothing is changing, something is changing. One of these fine days I will show you, when you do parenting, I will show you cartoons that have got sexual messages that can be seen. And what the devil is looking for is a subconscious mind. Because if you can deposit it in the mind, subconscious mind, it is done. Some of you can remember a perfume your teacher used to wear when in class one. How did you remember? Because the subconscious is more powerful. You don't even tell your subconscious mind to remember. It goes down there. And when you smell that perfume, you can remember, this smells like my teacher. Or this smells like my mother. So you need to be careful, because this is what happening. Your heart is your ground. Take care of your ground. You don't have to watch a movie because everybody's watching. You don't have to. There are things you switch off completely. Guard your heart. Proverbs 4:23. Guard your heart with all diligence. Because that is your ground. You can't allow too much water to come on that ground. Because too much water, that's why I say, you can't be living. You know, there are people who watch, and it is not wrong, but there are people who watch sermons from different places, from morning to evening. By the time you're done, you can't even, you don't know where your faith is. Because there are people who will teach different things. Unafunzwa hii, unafunzwa hii, unafunzwa hii, unafunzwa. And I'm not saying there's nothing wrong in listening if you're mature. But there are some sermons you listen like this and somebody will confuse you. By the end of the day, all the seeds that were planted, you are overwatered. And you don't even know which one to believe for. You have more than you can handle. You'd rather receive, take one seed that is precious. Deal with it until you get a harvest. So watch your ground. Number three, your understanding. Your understanding, that's what the Bible says in Proverbs 4:7. That wisdom is a principal thing, and Lord, you're getting, get understanding. Because all the devil is looking for is lack of understanding. Lack of understanding. The reason why there are so many people who have never given their life to Christ, because they don't understand where they're headed. They think because I came to church that you're closer to heaven. No. As long as you've never given your life to Christ, you are as far from heaven as the day you were born. That's how far you are. Having sitting in church for a good sermon does not bring you closer to God. Never. It is giving your life to Christ, because people have never understood. People think it is all about going to hell. And so you feel like only tomorrow and not go to hell. Some people do not understand that when they fornicate, that they are destroying the seed of God that has been planted in them. The Bible says any man or woman who commits adultery lacks understanding, and you destroy your own soul. You destroy your own soul. What is your soul? You destroy your emotions. You destroy your willpower. You destroy your mind. Any man or woman, if you think that you're Vatican, well, in the future, you don't commit adultery. You think you're okay. Because you woke up in the morning and customers came to your shop. You think it's okay. God is not looking at your physical shop. He's looking at your soul, at your mind, at your emotion. Something is destroyed. The Bible says, whoever commits adultery lacks understanding. And not only adultery, even fornication. So you, if you're watching pornography, because the Bible, Jesus said, if you look at a woman, lustfully, or a man, you have committed adultery. You have. Well, kula na macho kutoka asubuhi mpaka jioni. Kula, endelea kula tu. But you are lacking understanding, and you are destroying your own soul. That's what you are doing. You are destroying it. That's why many people are not progressing. Because the devil is saying, don't ever cheat, but have a look and look again. So your will, your emotions, your mind, which is the ground. Because when the Bible talks about the heart here, he's not only talking about this heart. He's talking about your soul. He's talking about your soul. Because your mind, the Bible, when he talks about, whenever you see the heart, he's talking about the component of this heart and the component of your mind, your entire soul, your soul. Your soul, which is your will, your mind, your emotions. You destroy them. You destroy them. So that's why I say understanding. 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 I finish by saying, pay careful attention to the word you have received from God. Pay careful attention. Pay careful attention. Number two, protect that word. Protect that word. Protect it. Number three, pray. Pray that word until you get results from that word. Number four, speak that word. Speak it. Speak it. Speak it. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 18. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 18. 1 Timothy. It's in the Bible. 1 Timothy chapter 1 verse 18. This charge I commit unto you, son Timothy, according to the prophecies which went before on you, that you by them might wage a good warfare. This charge I commit unto you, son Timothy, according to the prophecies which went before on thee, that you by them mightest war a good warfare. This charge I commit unto you, son Timothy, according to the prophecies which went before on you. The word of God is a sure word of prophecy. Every time the word of God comes to you, that is prophecy. And God is giving you a charge today that by the seeds that God has sown into your life, those are the prophecies which have gone before concerning you. Wage a good warfare. Fight until you get a harvest.
Amen.
One as you feel it.
Amen.
Fight with the word, with the prophecy, until you get a good harvest. Many pick one word, then they pick another one, they pick another one, they pick another one, and they have too many battles. If you have been living God for a husband, take that word, hold on to it, remember what God says about it. Remember what the prophets have prophesied. Somebody came and prophesied and said, this year you will get born again. You know, I see people on WhatsApp, and in Wameshika Mai, they are waiting for the pastors who say, this year we will get born again. Somebody, a good Christian, sharing it on WhatsApp group. That is why the devil is making a mockery of you, because that is the way you treat the world. Because instead of taking stones to wage warfare against the devil concerning the prophecies that came not to be because they were stolen, you're looking for the pastor who prophesied to become rich. Instead of taking that word and waging a good warfare, that's what the Bible says. This charge I commit unto you, son Timothy, according to the prophecies that went on before on you, that you might wage a good warfare. Take the word of God, protect it, pray concerning that word of God, speak that word of God, wage warfare for that word of God until you get the desired results. Until you get the desired results. Until. God is not responsible for your failure. It is the responsibility of bringing forth a harvest is on you. Say on me. It is on you. It is not on the pastors. It is on you. If anything is not happening in your life, look, do you have a seed that is in your heart? Did you understand that seed? Did you pray? Have you protected it? Have you pushed on it? If you have not, it is your responsibility. Let us stand on our feet.